1. Go ahead, guys.
All right. Well, good evening, everybody. And God
bless you. How we going out there?
All right. Listen, we are really excited for this conclusion of this four-week series. And we certainly want to thank everybody who's been with us on this particular journey, because we genuinely believe here in Vallejo that we have declared the city of God, that nothing beats a bullet like a job. Man, it can really transform lives. And it's been a blessing for us to be able to do what we've been able to do through the grace of God and working with our sheriff's department and city government. And just as a kingdom organization, Michael's Transportation, you heard some of the story of how it got started some 30 plus years ago. And we are really excited about what God is doing. And we say it humbly, but we are totally grateful for the blessings of the Lord. And also, one thing that we know for certain is that one of the major components of keeping life healthy, wholesome, and just good are the principles of prayer evangelism. And that's what we're going to close with tonight. And before we get started, I just wanted to see, allow Michael to say something here and lead us into this lesson for tonight.
Well, again, we're going to be talking about prayer evangelism according to Jesus. I was looking for some letters that we had just gotten written by the mayor of the city, by one of the Solano County judges, and by the our Department of Corrections and our sheriff of Solano County, all of them in support of our, no, that's all right. It's okay. Yeah, all that are in support of our program that we have as far as second chance. It's something that is not only valuable to us here in the city of Vallejo and Solano County, but we think the model will be very effective throughout the state of California. And they are saying the same. We don't have them with us right now, but perhaps we can maybe have them posted with this presentation. So the whole university will have an opportunity to enjoy them like we have. We didn't realize we had the support that we had in our city and that we are making a difference in the lives of so many families. That being said, we'd like to start with prayer, evangelism according to Jesus, taken from Luke 10, verses 1 through 17. It says, the river of transformation, prayer evangelism, when adopted as a lifestyle by the body of Christ, creates a river of transformation that impacts the entire city. Prayer evangelism requires four simple steps that allows a believer to change the spiritual climate wherever they go. And to support that statement, you can go to 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 8, Acts 26, verse 18, and then also 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. Luke 10, verse 1, it says, after these things, the Lord appointed 70 others also and sent them two by two before his face into every city and place whither himself would come. Now, the question is, who were the 70? Well, we believe they were marketplace ministers and pulpit pastors. Where did they come from? Well, we believe they came from the marketplace. Well, how were they sent out to witness? Well, don't miss this. They were sent out two by two. And so where did they go to witness? Well, we believe they went to the marketplace. So what does God expect of us? And the answer would be no less. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 19 lets us know that them that are in Christ or new creations, yes, and old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new, and all things are of God, who have reconciled us and have given us a ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing or counting their trespasses unto them. And so this is the message that God has given every believer in the body of Christ to go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so,
amen.
Next.
Yeah, and I just want to just add this one little thing. That Luke 14:23 is certainly one of my favorite passages. And again, many of you know the story where the master of the house made a great supper and bade many, and just asked many people to come, and folks started making all kinds of excuses. Mm-hmm. But in the midst of that, the Lord said, well, listen, you go out into the highways and hedges, the streets and lanes of the city, and compel people to come in that my house may be filled. And I just want to encourage each and every one of you listening that when you go and do kingdom work, it's not only easier to do it with somebody else, but it's a lot more fun doing it with somebody else. And it takes much pressure off. I tell you, it really becomes an enjoyable mission when you're not trying to change the world by yourself, knowing that you're called to change the world. Amen. So, yes, indeed. So we bless you in that indeed.
And it helps you to not take yourself that serious.
Amen.
Now, what happened with the 12 disciples mentioned in Luke 9? We're not talking about the 70 in Luke 10, but before he called the 70, he called out the 12. Hmm. In Luke 9, and after Jesus gave them power over all devils and diseases, just like he gave the 70 in the marketplace believers, then he taught them the four steps of prayer evangelism. But now, in the 9th chapter, he's teaching those four principles to the 12 disciples and sending them out.
Amen.
And so one of the things that he taught them was in, and then they went out with those principles in mind, but in Luke 9, verse 12 through 17, in spite of the authority given to the 12, they wanted to send the multitude away without their needs being met.
Hmm.
And it isn't proper to present a Jesus that is unable to meet the people's needs.
Mm-hmm.
Because Paul said, according to Philippians 4:19, and my God is able.
That's right.
To provide our every need according to his riches in Christ Jesus. And so we're not drawing from our resources ever, but we're drawing from the resources of heaven.
Hmm.
And God is able to meet the needs of the people. And so this was the first encounter that they had when they went out on their own. And so they kind of missed the mark.
Amen. There you go. And Jesus was still able to feed the multitudes with two fish and five loaves.
And so in 9 and 38 through 43, these same 12 disciples couldn't cast the devil out of the man's son. They were given power to heal, but failed to use it by faith. And so we see again that even though they had the ability to heal, deliver, and to set free, they were unable to cast the devil out of that man's son. And so this is when Jesus questioned their faith. Oh, ye of so little faith. And so they had the faith, but they failed to use their faith in this particular situation.
Amen. And if I could just interject just one small point as Michael's continuing on. It's bad to need something and not have it, but it's even worse to have something and not realize what you have. And Jesus had given them power to heal the sick and cast out all foul spirits and to heal all manner of sickness and disease. It was already in their hands.
Praise God. All right, and so then again in Luke 9, verses 46 through 48, these same 12, they argued about who would be chief among them when they entered into the kingdom. They were more concerned with political power than they were with the spiritual authority that Jesus had given them when they went out. And so they were concerned about who was going to sit on his left and who was going to sit on his right when he entered into his kingdom. And Jesus took that as a teaching moment to let them know at this particular time, Caesar was in power and everything was serving Caesar. But he realized that that was not the model that he came to establish for the kingdom. And so he let them know, he says, listen, the Gentiles usurp authority over you and rule over you, but it would not be among you, but he that would be chief among you, let him be the servant of all. And so what Jesus was doing was turning that hierarchy upside down, where instead of the many serving the few, he turned it on its head and said, in the kingdom, the few will serve the many. Instead of operating in an exclusive system, Jesus was establishing an inclusive system that supported the multitude.
Amen. And even in Luke 9, again, this was such an interesting passage because there was so much confrontation going on here before they recognized the power that they had. But again, the 12 disciples in 9:49-56, the 12 disciples wanted to call down fire from heaven after being rejected. Through our verbal and nonverbal communication, we demonstrate judgment and condemnation rather than love and acceptance toward those that disagree with us. Amen. And so again, we as people of God, we must know that it is our charge to bless and not curse. And as we often say, you can always reverse a curse, but you cannot reverse a blessing. Amen?
Amen.
And so we thank the Lord Jesus for that as well. And we just want to encourage all of us as a part of the Transformation family and as kingdom people to make sure that we are blessing all the more. And again, the Bible teaches us that, again, in that Ephesians passage, that we can be angry, but do not sin, and don't let the sun go down on our wrath. Because sometimes, even with those that are closest to us, when we get a little agitated by them, it's easy to become judgmental, and it's easy to become condemning rather than loving people into a greater relationship with the Lord.
And I just love this picture because I think it is a perfect depiction of a believer who has been opposed or somebody has questioned his position that he's taken on a particular subject. And so that's one thing as believers that we must avoid with all costs, because it is our anger that gives space to the devil.
And the word says in that 27th verse of Ephesians 4, give no place to that scoundrel.
Hallelujah.
Give no place to the devil. Amen. And so here we are in Luke 10:2, where it says that, therefore, he said unto them, the harvest is truly great, but the laborers are few. Pray, therefore, that the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. Why? Because the harvest was great and ready then, and is great and ready right now. I like to say often, there is just no shortage of sinners. Amen. I don't know about wherever else you are in the world, but in Vallejo, they are none short. So, but here in Solano County, but that's why he has called us to go into the vineyard. Mm-hmm. And the problem Jesus had then was not that he didn't have enough laborers. The problem was they were in the barns and not in the field where they were needed. Amen. Wow, sounds like today, doesn't it? And just like today, our shepherds are behind the four walls instead of in the marketplace 24/7. And again, we really believe with all of our heart in this quote-unquote end time revival, or in this climate right now, the next revival is absolutely starting in the marketplace.
Praise God. Yeah, Amen. And we believe that with all of our heart. And the example that Jesus gave to all of the listening pastors out there, that when he saw the multitude, the Bible says he had compassion on them because he saw them as sheep having no shepherd. And so, pastors, it is paramount that you not only be ministers or pastors in your local church, but that you have the heart of the city.
Mm-hmm.
Is because Jesus only cried, I believe, twice in the Bible. It was over Lazarus, his friend, and it was over Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
He cried, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, when I would hover you as a hen would hover her brood, but you would not." And so we would just like to encourage the pastors to look out and see that Jesus has other sheep, which are not of this fold. He says, "Them I also must bring, and there should be one fold and one shepherd."
Amen. And therefore, before we go, I just want to encourage, I know for me, again, working with Dr. Ed Savoso, the vision and the idea of pastoring a whole city,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to a local congregation, has made all the difference in our ministry and in how, in my own perception as a pastor of a local church.
Yes.
And again, what has happened from that, the residual effect of working to pastor the city, not only have we been able to bless the leaders of our city, then we've been able now to bless the city of our, the leaders of our county. And God now, even as late as yesterday in meeting with our sheriff, he again said, "Oh, okay, you wanna have some conversation on the state level, then let me help you to mm-hmm. get there at another level." And in fact, he said, "You better brace yourself, because when it comes, it's going to come in a big way." So we
Amen.
Bless the Lord Jesus for that, because
yes.
it's only because of his grace and his mercy. And we're so really glad about it. Amen.
Amen. We've been given the authority over the kingdom of darkness. However, we spend most of our time inside our barn with our light shining with other lights and not on the harvest that is out in the dark places of our city. The 70 were asked to pray for laborers. It wasn't that he didn't have enough laborers. He didn't have enough of the right kind. And so it is so important that we realize that Jesus has empowered us. He says, "I give unto thee the keys of the kingdom. And what you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Mm-hmm. And what you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven." In Acts 9, you'll see that instead of Jesus preaching the gospel to the apostle Paul when mm-hmm. he met him mm-hmm. on the Damascus road, when Paul asked him, "Who art thou, Lord?" He said, "I am Jesus whom you persecute." And I do. Now, Jesus could have told him himself, but he didn't. He told him to go down to Damascus
mm-hmm.
and there'll be a man, a human being down there to tell you what you must do.
Right.
To be saved. And because he has given us the ministry of reconciliation, Jesus has given us the keys to the kingdom. And it's so important that we realize and that we walk in that authority, because he's given us the capacity through the gospel of Jesus Christ
yes.
to change the human heart, praise God, from darkness to light. And so we as believers must realize we all have that ministry of reconciliation, and that we are not like other people. We can impact our spheres of influence. Matter of fact, in Joshua 23, one of us can chase 1,000, and two of us, as we are today, can put 10,000 to a flight. Praise God. And so when we come together as believers and believe God
Amen.
That he will work through us,
Amen.
Miracles start to happen.
Amen. And when you go back, I just wanted to go back for just a moment to this slide before we move forward, because there was one thing that was said in the John 12 passage in that 32nd verse, actually 31, 32, and it simply says that now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world is cast out, bless God. And Jesus then again says, and if I be lifted up,
hallelujah,
then I'll draw all people unto myself. And it doesn't matter who they are. It doesn't matter if they look like us, if they live where we live in the same economic or socioeconomic conditioning, or no matter what, who they are, if we just lift up the name of Jesus, he will do the drawing, but he'll use us as a pivot to reach those that are lost, that are hurting, that are in need. And believe me, people are hurting at every level.
Amen. Glory to God. Yes, our traditional shepherds, God bless them, are focused on the membership instead of the unbelievers and the healing of the land.
Yes.
Nothing could be more opposed to Jesus' teaching about the role of the pastor. And you can find that in Luke 15, 1 through 7, when he is talking about what man has 100 sheep and does and one goes astray. Does he not leave the 99 and go and search for that one? And how long will he search for them? The Bible says until he finds them.
Right.
And so Jesus is concerned about those that have been disenfranchised, those that have been left out, those that have been rejected. I like the words that the pastor uses about the lost, the least, the least, the last, and the lost.
Amen.
Are the ones in which Jesus is very much concerned about today.
Amen. And before you go, I want to just add this, because at the beginning of that passage in Luke 15, it's really interesting that Jesus, he was actually with the tax collectors and the sinners. And then the religious people, they looked at him with criticism and said, listen, look, he's eating with sinners. Amen. But I don't know. I hope you hear me on anybody glad that the Lord Jesus took time with sinners, because if not, where will you and I be today?
Hallelujah.
So we bless the Lord Jesus that he took time with sinners and we were able to repent of our sins and what we gave our lives to him. And therefore, even as this message is saying, there is a big difference between a church member and a laborer. Mm-hmm. A church member ministers within the four walls of the church, while the laborers minister 24/7 in the marketplace where the unbeliever spends most of their time.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And so, go ahead.
Luke 10, verse 3. It says, go your way. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves. Does the Lord really want his sheep hanging around wolves? The short answer is yes.
Amen.
But why is Jesus ascending the disciples into hostile territory and putting them in harm's way? Simple. Or maybe it's simple. Because he loves them.
Amen.
Praise God. And so you know that when God demonstrated his love toward us, do you know that it was while we were yet sinners that he died for the ungodly? And we must remember that when we quote John 3 and 16, it's an inclusive message and not an exclusive message, because it says that God so loved the world.
Yes.
Stop right there.
Amen.
And God still loves that world, and he loved them enough to give us his very best.
Amen. You know, I love this, Captain, because it gives me a reminder. Some of you know that we do what we call our church without walls in the country club Crest in the hood in Vallejo. And last night, people of God, it was very interesting. Myself and some of the brothers, we were able to walk the community last night. And when we walked the neighborhood, we were able to spend some time praying with persons who we know were alcoholics and other things. And And they were on one side, and then some of the hip hop generation were on the other side. But we did a Joshua walk around the building. But when we got to the place where it was time for us to pray, those alcoholics put down alcohol, weed, anything else, and they came together for prayer. One received the Lord, the other in the wheelchair, amen, was just blessed and was felt like he was ready to walk, you know, and just to see the miracle, amen. And even one gentleman who we know was formerly inebriated, he began to speak the word, amen. And so just to see those lives being transformed right before our eyes was a blessing. And then we went and met with the hip hop crowd and began to pray for them. And so what I'm saying to us, two by two, it makes everything easier. Of course, we had a smaller group for us last night, but that were able to go out and minister to maybe 50 or 60 people. But I'm just saying to each and every one of you that's listening, God did not give us a spirit of fear, but he gave us a spirit of love, power, and a very strong and sound mind.
Praise God.
And honestly, he doesn't want anybody, as 2 Peter 3:9 says, to perish, to die, and go to hell. He wants them in his hands. Praise Amen? God.
He wants everybody. Luke 10:4 reads, "Carry neither purse, nor scrip, nor shoes, and salute no man by the way." Why do you think they were asked to take no purse or scrip or shoes and not to salute anyone along the way? Jesus teaches us about kingdom provision and the urgency of the gospel message. According to the scripture, our prosperity is connected to our ministry.
Amen.
If you go to Matthew 6:33, it says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness."
Yes.
And then he says, all of these things
right?
that the Gentiles seek after, he said, "I'll just add them."
Come on.
And so we must keep first things first.
Man.
We take care of God's business, and guess what? God has promised us he will take care of ours.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And before you go, and I just have to add, Michael just said it at the end, but I just want to reiterate it again. When he said, "Don't take anything with you, don't worry about what you're going," the Lord, I don't know who this is for, but I want to encourage somebody tonight. Know that the Lord will take care of you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And that's just what something that's in my spirit to say, he will absolutely take care of you when you're doing his kingdom ministry.
Hallelujah. Luke 10:5. "And into whatsoever house you enter or business, first say, 'Peace be to this house.'"
Yes.
All right. And so this is the first step of prayer evangelism, is to speak peace and blessings wherever we go. We need to declare peace because we as believers have been at war with the unbeliever. If we bless the unbeliever, we will stop cursing him. Why should we bless the unbeliever? A blessing is stronger than a curse.
Man.
You can break a curse. The Bible declares and proves that. But you cannot break a blessing.
That's right.
Praise God. God's blessings on our lives are irrevocable. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. When you're blessed, you're just blessed.
Amen. Amen.
We speak peace in order to neutralize the demons that have been assigned to blind our neighbors to the light of the gospel of Christ. Praise God. And so,
yes.
The power of the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the gospel of the unconditional, undeserved, and unmerited love of God, will take the blinders off of any human being's eyes if they can ever hear the unadulterated gospel of God's grace.
Yes.
And this is what God had called the Apostle Paul to. He was preaching the law at one point, and then he turned around, he met Jesus on the Damascus Road, and he came back preaching Christ, and those Judaizers decided that they were not going to eat until they killed him.
Yes.
Praise God. But his ministry had become so effective, not just among the Jews, mm-hmm. but also very powerful among the Gentiles, is because he preached a gospel of grace.
Amen.
Praise God.
And that grace, again, it says in that 2 Corinthians passage, but even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. And saints, the only way is going to shine on them is through us. Amen. And as I had to share with someone just this morning, and even again yesterday, the only way, the problem with darkness is simply the absence of light.
Hallelujah.
And that's why Jesus said that we are the light of the world.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We are that city that sits on a hill that cannot be hidden. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So step one, prayer evangelism, step one. As Michael was just saying, we speak peace to every house that you enter. Mm-hmm. Prayer evangelism, and this is key, is a lifestyle of blessings. You bless your city, you bless your elected official, you bless your boss, you bless your co-workers, you bless your neighbors,
and
even your enemies, everyone in the sphere of your influence. And in fact, people of God, the one thing we didn't say up there is we mean it with all of our heart, even start with your family, because too often, amen, we're not blessing even those that are closest to us. Amen.
Praise God.
So again, we must be open to being a blessing.
Praise God. Yeah, yes. I think in Jeremiah, I think it's 29:7, mm-hmm. kind of confirms this even in the Old Testament. And seek the peace of the city,
yes,
where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it. For in its peace,
yes,
you will have peace.
Right.
For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are in your midst deceive you, nor listen to your dreams which you caused to be dreamed.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, Israel was in captivity, and there were two messages that they received while they were in Babylon. One message was, let's arm ourselves and go to war against the Babylonians to deliver ourselves from this captivity. But Jeremiah had a different message for them. He was saying, listen, y'all, I want you to pray. What? I want you to pray for your enemy.
Yes.
I want you to do good to that despitefully use you and are saying all manner of evil against you. And he was saying, pray for them, because he said, in their peace,
right,
we shall have peace, because it was the will of God to put them in captivity for the 70 years because of their disobedience. Mm-hmm. And so they would have been fighting against God to fight against the enemy of that day. And so it's important for us to realize today, if our cities are going to be delivered, they're going to be delivered by the words of the righteous.
Amen.
That is speaking peace over our city.
Because again, and in that Proverb 11, I'll start back with 11 and 10, because it says, when it goes well with the righteous, the city rejoices.
Hallelujah.
But when the wicked perish, there is jubilation. But in verse 11, it does say in the A clause, by the blessings of the upright, a city is exalted.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise so again, God. For those of us as kingdom people, we make our city better. God has charged us to do that. And therefore, why speaking peace is so important, too often repent or burn is the banner which we approach the unsaved. Unfortunately, we have a tendency to strongly dislike sinners. And this soon becomes obvious, oh my God, to those particular persons.
Praise God. You know the two men who went up to the temple to pray? One prayed thus for themselves, saying, Lord, I am not like the others,
right?
I do this and I do that.
Right.
The poor publican, he had nothing to boast in. He said, Lord, simply have mercy. On me, a sinner.
Right.
And so Jesus asked the question, which one went down justified? Mm-hmm. In other words, which one of these prayers that I honor? And it was the one who humbled himself.
Amen.
Because he that humbles himself shall be exalted, but he that exalts himself shall be abased. Praise God. And so Luke 6:10-6. And if the Son of Peace be there,
yes,
your peace shall rest upon it. If not, it shall return. It shall return to you again.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Spirit looks.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
This is good stuff.
For resting place. In other words, the Holy Spirit within is for you.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit without is for others.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Holy Spirit is looking for a place to rest. And if he wanted to rest on your shoulders, how would you conduct yourself?
Hmm.
It's a very good question.
Amen.
Your neighbors may come to you and say something like, when I see you walking by, I get a positive vibration. That's New Age lingo for peace.
Yes.
What they mean is that in your presence, they feel something tangible.
Yes.
And they like it. And guess what that is?
Hmm.
It's the Holy Spirit of God, because you are walking in a non-judgmental attitude.
Amen.
You have not passed judgment on them because of their lifestyle, what they look like, how they talk, praise God. And because you have not judged them,
mm-hmm.
they feel something emanating from you, which we believe is the anointing of God that can change the human heart.
And can I say this one little example? Michael and I were grabbing some breakfast or lunch last week, you know, and it was the most amazing thing. There was a Hispanic young lady who had a little girl that was in line, and I spoke to her in a few words in Spanish, but the little girl looked at me and said, I love you. And it just captured my heart.
Hallelujah.
I mean, and really it was out of nowhere, you know, but again, so you see, I'm stumbling over my words because it was such a blessing, but again, mm-hmm. when Jesus said, let your light so shine, it's not a matter of you having a neon sign on, amen, but it's just a matter of his presence. And your presence absolutely makes life better. And Holy Spirit looks for a resting place,
mm-hmm.
and he abides in us. The dove in Genesis is the symbol of peace.
Hallelujah.
It represents Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Holy Spirit is always looking for a resting place. He will rest upon anyone that's simply willing to host him.
Hallelujah.
And somebody say amen.
Amen.
Does indeed. And unbelievers love to hang around Jesus.
Yes.
I love this because there was just something about him that drew others to him.
Mm-hmm.
When people saw Jesus, they saw grace and truth. They never felt judged, condemned, or rejection.
Mm.
Our neighbors should feel the same way about us, as we are Jesus's ambassadors in the earth. Amen.
Praise God. Amen. We have to be very conscious of the fact wherever we go and whatever we are doing, we are his ambassadors.
Mm.
We are his representatives in the earth. And that's why Jesus said, if I be lifted up,
yes,
I will draw all men,
yes,
unto me. And so it is important for us to know that we are ambassadors. Therefore, we do not represent ourselves, but we represent someone else.
Yes.
And that the Bible is our constitution,
mm-hmm.
in which we are to be subject to in our walk with God.
Yes, and if I can just simply read that 2 Corinthians passage 20 and 21, I love this passage. It says, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ.
Hallelujah.
As though God were pleading, listen, pleading through us. Mm. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God, for he made him who knew no sin, God Almighty, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him.
Hallelujah.
Thank you,
glory to God. Amen. That, and you got to stop and really think about this.
Yeah.
That God is sending us to tell the lost that daddy loves you. Hmm. Daddy misses you. And daddy has sent me to tell you to come home.
Yeah.
Praise God. And so he says, come all you that are burdened, are heavy laden. And Jesus said, I'll give you rest.
Yes.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly, and ye shall find rest for your soul.
And I just wanted to add this one thing about that, because that love is so powerful. Again, for him who knew no sin became sin on our behalf.
Yes.
And again, that we now have been able to become righteous.
Hallelujah.
Through him. That's grace.
Hallelujah.
And amazing.
Right. Could you imagine us too, right, being representatives of his righteousness? What a divine exchange.
And I wanted to add to, you know, our topic is nothing beats a bullet like a job. And listen, not only have God blessed us to be able to change person's skill level, but the blessing in all of this, and the sheriff now who's having to be reelected, he shared with us yesterday, is that people's lives are changing. And even his own life from being around us, he said his heart has been changed. Hallelujah. And we bless the Lord Jesus for that.
Praise
Amen.
God. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Luke 10, verses 7 and 8. And in the same house remain eating and drinking such things as they give, for the laborer is worthy of his hire. Go not from house to house, and into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. Hmm. That is the second step of prayer evangelism, is fellowship.
Amen.
Amen. And so, go ahead.
And prayer evangelism, again, in the second step, fellowship with the lost. Well, why fellowship? Fellowship provides an opportunity for the believer to show the lost God's unconditional acceptance by expecting that the person, accepting the person, excuse me, just the way they are instead of the way we want them to be.
Wow.
My God. How big is that? Wow. And Jesus always treated persons with respect and acceptance. Mm-hmm. From Zacchaeus to the adulterous woman, he loved them all the same. Amen.
Amen.
And what value is fellowship with the unbeliever unless I share the gospel with them? Mm-hmm. Well, fishing requires patience. Any fisherman knows that he can't make the fish bite. Amen.
And this is where you really must have wisdom, because the Bible says, he that winneth souls is wise.
Yes.
And so as a fisherman, an experienced fisherman, we know that I don't care what pond that we're fishing in, we cannot make those fish bite. However, if we come with the correct bait,
yes,
we become an attraction to that fish, and therefore we don't leave empty-handed.
Amen.
And so the Bible says again, he that winneth souls is wise. And so Jesus never turned away a sinner, and he never disrespected them because of their lifestyle.
Amen. And when we follow him, I like this part, even as it relates to fishing, he said, I will make you,
hallelujah,
I will insist that you become, I will teach you, I will show you how to become fishers of men.
Hallelujah.
Lord, or of all people. All right.
Luke 10, verse 9.
Yes.
And heal the sick,
yes,
that are within, and say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you.
Hmm.
The third step is an opportunity to pray for their felt need.
Yes. This will only happen after they trust us enough to disclose their felt needs. So be patient with people. This is what is meant by heal the sick. It is important to know Jesus uses miracles, my God, to confirm his ministry. Even at the wedding feast, amen.
Yes, he
turned water into wine, amen. Again, Jesus, he allowed miracles to continue to happen and become a part of his demonstration. Praise God. We bless the Lord Jesus for that on tonight. And again, I just want to digress a bit to say, be patient with people as God is patient with us. And to heal the sick and ministering to a person's felt needs. That means you have to be willing to listen. Amen. And you know, the old saying goes that God gave us one mouth and two ears. Amen. So being patient enough to listen to people, I promise you, it will turn their hearts enough that when it comes time to go to step four, it'll be an easier transition. I love prayer evangelism. And there's one who used to be, you know, I love witnessing to people. I love winning the lost to Christ, but it was always getting Christ to them first. But prayer evangelism, I'll tell you honestly, for me personally, it has changed my life. And understanding that Jesus, he's not in a hurry.
Praise God.
He knows how to get things done, and he knows how to get it done correctly. So following the steps of blessing people, I love speaking blessings in the person's lives, and then taking some time with them, and then finding out what their felt needs are.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes, amen.
All right.
Yes, and sir. So it lets us know as believers that we have been empowered. Jesus did not take this power back to heaven with him when in Matthew's he declared that all power is given unto me in both heavens and in earth. But in Mark 16, he gives us some instructions on how to use that power. He simply instructed us to lay hands on the sick and the sick would recover. Now, many times we are faced with situations in our lives that appear to be impossible. But what is impossible with man is possible with God. And you may not realize it, but this situation that seems to be impossible that has been set before you is your opportunity to stand in the gap as an ambassador of the kingdom and simply an act of obedience.
Yes.
You lay hands on that person and you pray the promises of God over that life, because you don't know what God is about to do through you.
Yes.
We just know this, that God wants to work through us, and he has never left himself without a witness. And so be willing to stand in the gap and let God use you in those impossible situations.
Amen.
Because Jesus proves his identity by miracles. That's why he worked miracles to convince the unbeliever that Jesus is God.
Yes.
So amen. Don't be afraid of the power. Hallelujah.
Oh, God. And, you know, and that, before we go, that, you know, that's why I love working two by two, because some things are stirred up and agitated. At that wedding feast in John 2, it was so interesting. Mary, the mother of Jesus, she went to him, told him that the wine ran out. And then he says, you know, woman, mother, you know, what do I have to do with that? What does that have to do with me? And Mary, in her wisdom, I like what she said. She told the other servant, she said, whatever he tells you to do in that fifth verse, do it.
Hallelujah.
And I don't know who that download is for right there, but whatever the Lord Jesus is leading you to do, do it.
Do it.
Take the steps of faith, because prayer evangelism, the step three, third step is praying for the felt needs of the unbeliever. Why? 90% of Americans believe in God 80% of that 90% don't believe Jesus is God. Mm. Miracles are what God uses to convince the unbeliever that Jesus is God.
Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. And so we have this acronym. It's called PUSH.
Right.
Pray until something happens.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, indeed. And well, why miracles again? How was John the Baptist convinced that Jesus was the Messiah? By the miracles Jesus performed, mm-hmm. according to Luke 7, 19 through 23, mm-hmm. when the believers began to pray for the felt needs of the lost, God surprises them with almost immediate answers to prayer.
Hallelujah.
In fact, the prayer for the 100 sheep is the spiritual equivalent of dialing 911. Amen. And I know some of us have had to do that, right? Here I am, Jesus, yes, right now. This is an urgent one. And Jesus used miracles to convince Philip that he was God.
Yeah, see, Philip was a kind of a curious disciple.
Right.
He said, when Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled.
Yes.
You believe in God? He said, mm-hmm. believe also in me.
Right.
For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And Philip was standing there and says, well, you know, we know that the Lord God of Israel is one.
Right.
So we're not sure what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Let not your heart be troubled. So, I mean,
right.
Philip was taking issue with that statement. And so he said, I tell you what, show us the Father,
right.
and we'll be satisfied. Jesus said, Philip, how long have I been with you?
Mm-hmm.
You've seen me. You have seen the Father.
Amen.
I and my Father are one. Mm-hmm. But Philip, don't believe me because I told you who I was. Believe me for my work's sake.
Yeah.
In other words, believe me by the miracles that you see me performing day in and day out.
Yes.
That is my signature that I have came from the Father.
Amen.
Because that's how God uses the miracle power to convince people who he is. I was talking with the pastor today, and I says, you know, wisdom is really not the principal thing. And so he looked at me, and I looked at him. I already had the answer to it, because the apostle Paul, let us know in the book of Corinthians, mm-hmm. he said that I came not just with the enticing words of men's wisdom, but in power, and your faith would be in the power of God and not in the wisdom of men.
Amen.
And so God wants to show up and show out in our lives. We are just ordinary people that God has called to do extraordinary things. Amen?
Amen.
All right, here we go.
Yes, and you know, and we're only going to take about 2 more minutes. We're going to leave these five. You know, this is such a blessing for us to be able to share, and we do want to see if there are any questions that we can open up to at the end. But again, why miracles? Has the Lord equipped us with the power to convince the unbeliever today that Jesus is God? According to 2 Corinthians, yes, 4 and 7. Again, yes, we are. Yes, he's given us this treasure in earthen vessels.
Hallelujah.
And again, the presence of Holy Ghost, it is the treasure that he would dare entrust us with.
Hallelujah.
His Glory living presence mm-hmm. in us as vessels of clay.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God, God, for him to think enough of us to put himself in us, so that we can be like him in the earth.
Hallelujah. Amen. Able to do
exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us.
So we have to get past yes, no, and maybe so.
Right. Amen. Wow.
Step number 4.
All right.
We're going to get through this. What Jesus meant when he declared the kingdom of God has come near is that the Holy Spirit has come to bring the unbeliever to faith in Jesus Christ and enter into the kingdom of God. And so that those scriptures kind of confirm that. When you learn how to fish, you will allow the Holy Spirit to bring a person to a place of repentance. Mm. And that's what the Holy Spirit has done in all of our lives. Until the Holy Spirit wooed us, we were in no shape or form ready to turn to the Lord. Mm. We didn't find him, he found us.
Amen.
We didn't choose him, he chose us. And so we are to understand that it is God working through us that will touch that unbeliever's heart and cause them to turn from darkness to light.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
All right. And so we are going to open the floor up. You say, Pastor, yes. You have another comment?
Benji?
Yes, I'm here, guys. I'm here.
All right. Yes, indeed. Because again, we know that we have to wrap this up, but I just want to say early, it has been a real, I'll borrow a piece of Michael's verbiage, a plum pleasing pleasure to have been able to share in these last
four years.
Time has gone by so fast, and we really hope that for all who hears what we've been able to share from this, our city of Vallejo, that has been a blessing to you. We are sold out for transformation, prayer evangelism, and we bless Dad Ed and Mother Ruth that they're about to celebrate 50 years of marriage. And yes, so pray for us as well, Michael.
Well,
you yeah. Know, no, that's awesome, you guys. I think for everybody that's going to be watching this, everybody that's going to be, catching this later, I just hope everybody really catches the anointing that you guys have and that you model and have imparted. In particular, you know, 2x2. I know you guys have really taken that literally and really partnering together as you partner with the Lord. It's very, very powerful. And I just think it's, you know, what you guys are modeling there with really everything that you're doing, going 2x2, it's wonderful. It's also such a great demonstration of a pulpit minister and marketplace minister working together. And that is really, really awesome. So thank you guys so much for sharing and for imparting all that God has given you guys. I'll open it up to Betty. And if you have any further questions or comments, I'd love to hear them.
I don't have any questions. I love this last slide.
Amen.
Yeah, it makes it easy. When you present a Jesus that loves unconditionally,
that's right.
In unmerited love, yeah, it makes it very easy. And it simply, go ahead.
No, absolutely. Keep going.
Yeah. And you know, that Romans 10 simply says, if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus. But before we even got to that principle in Matthew 11, where Jesus said, come, all ye that are burdened and are heavy laden. I think that would probably include all of America,
amen,
and the rest of the nations of the world. And I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
Yes.
Not a religion, but learn of Christ. And I am meek and lowly, and you shall find, he said it again, rest for your soul, because the world is looking for a resting place. Mm. And they can find that resting place in our Jesus if we could just lift him up in all that we say, and again, all that we do. Mm. And it makes it so easy. If we confess the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Mm. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and then with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Praise God. And so this is what this whole mission is about. And we appreciate Carolyn giving us an opportunity to make this presentation.
Absolutely.
And to become a part of the university. I took her years and patience, but she has learned how to fish. And so she finally fished us out.
Amen.
And for that, we are glad. We appreciate you, Benji, and your patience and the time that you spent with us trying to, you know, prepare us. We thank Ed for all that he has done for us. He has taught us. He has brought us. And he has caused us to become people that we never thought in our lifetime we could become. And for that, we are all eternally grateful for this opportunity.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you guys so much for all of your efforts in putting this course together. I know many, many people are going to be blessed, encouraged, equipped as they take a look at things in the days ahead. And so thank you guys. We bless you and bless the city of Vallejo and Michael's Transportation to continue to expand as you expand the kingdom of God and all of that. So thank you everybody for joining us, and God bless you.
God bless you. God bless you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.